Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We now move on to another overview, this time on the projects market with top project owners, some of the main market drivers and a future outlook. To tell us more, please give a very warm welcome to Edward James, the Director of Content and Analysis at MEED Projects.
Thank you, Laura. Hello, everyone. My name is Ed. I'm the Director of Content Analysis at MEED Projects. And over the next 25 minutes or so, I'll be giving you a brief overview and outlook for the projects market in the MENA region. Now, before I start, I just wanted to tell you a little bit about where I work. I work for MEED Projects, which is a projects tracking service covering all major projects in the Middle East and Africa regions. And it's by tracking projects across all the different markets, geographies and sectors that we're able to quantify different trends, opportunities and challenges in the market. And the majority of the data that you see today is sourced from MEED Projects. If you want to find out a bit more, please feel free to click onto our website. So let's start by when we're looking at the projects market. Let's start by looking at the last year or the last couple of years. So we can see here on this slide that the value of MENA of contracts awarded in the MENA region has had its ups and downs over the last decade. We can see that between 2013 and 15, we saw a peak in terms of contract spending in the MENA region. A lot of that was due to the fact that the oil price was above $100 a barrel, so the governments had a lot more money to spend on projects. And of course, when we're looking at the MENA projects market, the majority of spending is from the is public spending. So when the governments have greater revenues from oil sales, they are able to spend more on projects. Then we saw in late 2014 and 15, the fall in the oil price from above $100 a barrel to less than $25 a barrel at one point. And in the last few years, we've seen the projects market fall as a result, reaching just $148 billion in 2019. And unfortunately, last year, as a result of the global pandemic and a further fall in oil demand and oil prices, we saw project spending overall in the region fall to just $113 billion. That's a 24% fall on the 2019 figure. That's not really surprising given the economic situation globally as a result of the pandemic. But nonetheless, last year was the worst year for a couple of decades in the region in terms of project spending. But when we're looking at the project spending overall on a country by country level, there is a slightly different story to tell. You can see here in this graph that Saudi Arabia and UAE are historically the largest projects markets in the MENA region. After all, they do have the largest economies, and in the case of Saudi Arabia, the largest population in the GCC. However, they were also the two markets worst hit in 2020. We saw project spending in Saudi Arabia fall by nearly half, from $49 billion in 2019 to just $23 billion last year. The UAE fell from $32 billion to $21.6 billion last year. However, if we look at other markets, we look at Egypt, we look at Qatar, Iraq, Oman, Kuwait, Algeria, project spending was either flat, stable year on year, or even grew in some examples. So when we're looking at the trends in the projects market, I think it's important to distinguish and not overgeneralize. It's important to distinguish on a country-by-country basis. There are different dynamics, drivers, which are impacting project spending. And as we can see clearly here, for some markets, last year was pretty bad. On the other hand, on other markets, it was actually quite good. And I think that's a very important consideration when looking at the projects market as a whole. Now, if you have any doubts about the impact of COVID on project spending last year, this graph would serve to underline the fact that the pandemic had a very substantial impact on project spending overall. Prior to lockdown and the emergence of the coronavirus in the region, project spending was running along at about $8.2 billion worth of contracts a month on average in the 5 months up to the point of lockdown. And then when lockdown hit, we see that project spending overall declined very sharply each month and registered a little under $4 billion a month on average for the remainder of the year. So we can see here in this graph how project spending is directly affected by the impact of lockdown and the emergence of the COVID-19 across the region. So very clear and obvious here that impact. Now, I think it's worth looking at also the UAE market in a little bit more detail. Obviously, the UAE projects market was for a long time the largest projects market in the region, particularly driven by construction spending in the real estate market in Dubai. You can see here Dubai is the red line, and that between 2012 and 2019, Dubai was by far the largest area of project spending in the UAE and within the region as a whole, indeed. But as we've seen over the last few years, we've seen project spending decline, we've seen project property prices lower, we've seen an oversupply of property in the UAE real estate market, and as a result, we've seen fewer project launches in Dubai and the projects market decline over the last few years. And indeed, last year, as a result of this, and combine that with the pandemic, we saw project spending in Dubai fall below the Abu Dhabi number for the first time in several years. And indeed, when we're looking at decline overall in the MENA projects market, this fall in Dubai has been a major driver for that. So one of the key aspects of the market in recent years has been this overall decline in project spending in Dubai. And that has created or compelled companies which had previously been focused on the Dubai market to start looking at new opportunities overseas in countries like Saudi Arabia, in Egypt, in Africa, and other countries in the GCC in order to find new opportunities as the Dubai market declined. So that was last year, the years prior to that. We know last year was very difficult. We know the global situation economically was very difficult. So now the question is, how has the market recovered in 2021? Have we seen the market rebound strongly this year? Well, as of the end of October, the first 10 months of the year, with only 2 months to go, we can see from this graph that the market has recovered somewhat from the difficulties we experienced last year, but it's still some way off returning to pre-pandemic levels. You can see here that in the first 10 months of 2021, about $102 billion worth of contracts were awarded in the MENA region, compared with $113 billion last year. And with 2 months to go, one would expect the overall total for the year to exceed last year's number, but still to be some way off the 2019 number of $149 billion. So we have seen a recovery. We haven't seen the market deteriorate further, but neither have we seen the market recoup some of those losses and return to pre-pandemic levels. And so now attention is quickly focusing on 2022 to see where that takes us and whether all that backlog of projects, which have now built up as a result of delays in project spending, whether that will start now flowing through into 2022 and whether we'll see a resurgence over the next 12 months. Now, just take a look at 2021 data on a country basis. Again, we can see that spending is very much, the outlook for the year is very much depending on what country you're focusing on. We can see here that Qatar is by far and away the largest projects market this year, primarily as a result of massive spending on the LNG program in the States. We also see Egypt and Iraq likely to exceed last year's figures. On the other hand, we are not seeing a recovery in the UAE projects market. We're still seeing quite difficult conditions in Dubai real estate sector. And we're also not seeing a strong recovery in Saudi Arabia. So that has meant that Qatar is now likely to become the largest projects market in the MENA region for the first time ever. And we're also likely to see Egypt and Iraq overtake the UAE projects market for the first time. You can see that here, again, illustrated in this graph. You can see here that Qatar has far exceeded the previous 2 years, primarily as the one-off LNG investment. We can also see Egypt and Iraq are likely to exceed last year's numbers and maybe even 2019 numbers. On the other hand, we can see the UAE is continuing to decline. And that is a result, that is obviously results in a lower overall spend for the region, is dragging back overall region spending. Saudi Arabia, on the other hand, may well hit last year's numbers, although again, will be far off the 2019 total. Now, who are the top contractors currently working in the construction and transport sector in the MENA region? You can see here that China State is by far the largest single contractor, with close to $8 billion worth of projects currently in hand. I think it's interesting to note the emergence of Chinese contractors over recent years. 10 years ago, we were talking about Korean contractors. 20 years ago, we were talking about Japanese contractors. Today, the talk is all about the emergence of the Chinese contractors. Have come in very strong on the back of the Belt and Road Initiative. They're bringing in finance to projects, and as a result, they're winning a lot of work. In the case of China State, China State is involved in the construction of their new capital in Cairo, as well as the new Alamein city in Egypt, and is also involved in a number of other iconic and key major projects across the region as a whole. In second place, we've got ABV Rock Group, the Saudi contractor, followed by its compatriot Nesman Partners, two mainstays in the Saudi construction and transport market, have been very successful in recent years. We've then got two Egyptian contractors, Arab Contractors and Orascom, who have both made hay as a result of the boom in construction in Egypt. We then have Bin Laden and then Urbicon out of Qatar. But you can see here, although we see China State being in first place, we also see Saudi, Egyptian contractors there. We also see that contractors from around the world are active in the region. We can see a WeBuild from Italy, Shapoji from India, Matna out of Turkey, Hanwha from Korea, Dimak from Turkey, Kolin from Turkey, and so on. Which just goes to show how open the MENA market is to international firms, international contractors, international suppliers, and consultants alike. The region is open for business from wherever you are based. There are no limitations, and the market has always been open to companies from around the world, which of course is very encouraging. Okay, so we've seen the data for the last decade, 2020, seen the data for this year. Now let's take a look at the future and the years ahead. So in the short term, we take simply projects currently where contracts have been tendered or under evaluation. We can see that there were approximately $43.5 billion worth of contracts in bid. And this is, of course, a key indicator of the short-term spending, because projects which have been tendered or where bids have already been submitted are those projects which are likely to be awarded over the next 3 to 6 months. And so the prognosis in the short term is very encouraging. Here we can see that of that $43.5 billion, $14 billion or so is in Saudi Arabia, followed by a little over $8 billion in the UAE, then Qatar, Oman, Egypt, Iran, and so on. So while 2020 has been very difficult, 2021 has also been quite challenging, we can be quite optimistic in the short term, just on the basis of this large number and value of projects currently in the market. This goes to show that there is a strong backlog of projects which have been delayed for the last 2 years, which have been awaiting to, which are waiting to be awarded. And this gives us very good hope that as we enter 2022, the market is going to accelerate and pick up quickly. So what are some of those projects currently out in the market? So just to give you a bit of flavour to and just crystallise what some of those opportunities are. Well, we've got the subsea power transmission network in Abu Dhabi, otherwise known as Project Wave. It's a very exciting project with international competition, expected to be awarded by the end of the year. We've then got a polypropylene plant in Alexandria in Egypt. We've got the Umm Shaif gas cap condensate development in Abu Dhabi. We've got pipelines in Algeria. We've got cement plants in Oman. We've got power redevelopments in Dubai. And indeed, we've got projects across different markets and different sectors. So there's opportunities for everyone. And again, this is just a small list of some of those key projects coming up. There are, of course, many dozens more which we expect to be awarded in the weeks and months ahead. Longer term, I think it's important to look at the overall macroeconomic growth forecast for the MENA region, key economies of the MENA region going forward. Now, as you can see here from the red columns, the red negative columns, it's again, no surprise, 2020 was a very difficult year. For most economies globally saw a decline in their GDP. However, the IMF is forecasting quite strong growth going forward over the next year to 5 years. You can see here that most of the major economies in the region are expected to show annual growth of at least 2% and as high as 6% going forward. And so that's obviously creates a lot of encouragement about the project market, because clearly the faster growing the economies, the greater the number of projects. Okay, so what's driving some of this project activity going forward? Well, first of all, I think what is critical is high population growth. Now, we've seen that the most resilient project markets in the last couple of years have been in Egypt and Iraq, countries which have very high growing population. When you've got strong population growth, you also have a requisite increase in demand for power and water facilities, production. You also got greater demand for social infrastructure like affordable housing and schools, hospitals, clinics, universities, and so forth. So strong demographic growth results in strong project market growth. Well, recently, we've also seen a focus on the energy transition of the oil-based economies in the region into renewable energy, and particularly the hydrogen economy over the last 12 months. Suddenly, we've seen a raft of hydrogen projects announced across the region, and this is new emerging sector will create a multitude of new project opportunities going forward. We also have, of course, aging infrastructure, particularly in transport, that needs to be invested in, particularly as the population grows and countries seek to attract inward investment. So that's going to be another focus of investment in projects. We've also got creating the framework for project spending, the government visions, the longer-term government visions, like Saudi 2030, which creates that framework for project investment. Gives an idea of where the map of project activity for the next decade or more, and indicates where governments are going to direct their spending. Likewise, something that's interrelated with this is the Belt and Road Initiative. We're talking about Chinese contractors becoming more dominant in the market. Well, a lot of that is due to Chinese investment in infrastructure and logistics in the region. Take Duqm, for example, or Kizad in Abu Dhabi. Huge amount of Chinese investment going through, and that in itself is creating investment or create a few more project opportunities, and we'll see an increase in project activity. In terms of the actual value of work longer term, Well, again, it's a very optimistic picture. We have more than $3.5 trillion worth of known future projects in the pipeline in the region. The largest market by a long way is Saudi Arabia, with more than $1.2 trillion of known planned and unawarded projects. $500 billion of that is the NEOM project, but even if we were to take that away, the kingdom is still by far and away the largest future market. And that's why so many companies are currently looking at it as for new business opportunities. We then have UAE, despite some of the recent challenges, with more than $600 billion of projects in the pipeline, still going to offer lots of long-term opportunities. We then have Egypt at more than $400 billion. And then Iraq, Kuwait, Iran, Qatar, Oman, all with more than $150 billion worth of known future projects. So despite some of those recent challenges in the last couple of years, we still have an extremely healthy long-term pipeline of projects. And even if only half of those were to actually materialize, there's still more than $1.7 trillion of known projects, which is a huge amount and more than enough to keep everyone busy for the foreseeable future. Just breaking down that same number by sector, you can see here that construction, as it has been historically, is going to be the largest future segment of project spending, with close to $2 trillion or 56% of total future project spending. We then have transport at nearly $500 billion, that's roads, ports, airports, seaports, and so on. And power, nearly $300 billion, oil, $235 billion. And so on. So it's across different markets and across different sectors, there are going to be opportunities for everyone. And then just finally to end off, in terms of who are the largest future clients going forward, again, this slide illustrates that there are opportunities across different markets, across different sectors. We've got many different key clients going to have billions of dollars of future projects, such as the National Authority for Tunnels in Egypt, which is responsible for high-speed railway and metro projects in the country. The Kuwait's Public Authority for Housing Welfare, which is in charge of affordable housing construction in the state. The Ministry of Housing in Riyadh, of course, in Saudi Arabia, which has billions of dollars of new units, hundreds of thousands of units coming up for affordable housing in the kingdom, and so on. You can see here that this list is dominated by public entities and reflects the public nature of project spending. But again, it also shows that future project spending is not in the hands of just one or two clients. It's across different markets and across different sectors and across different government entities. Then finally, what are some of those key future projects? Just to add a bit more flavor to just crystallize what those projects are. Well, we've got entertainment district in the new capital in Cairo. We've got metro project in Kuwait. We've got new refineries in Abu Dhabi. We've got a railway line in Saudi Arabia linking Jeddah with Riyadh. We've got a new airport in Bahrain. It just goes to show just exactly how many opportunities there are, but also how diverse the opportunities are across different markets and different sectors. And it just, again, just underlines the potential for the projects market in the region and the fact that there'll be so much work for everyone across the board and across different geographies. That brings me to the end of the presentation. I'll be happy now to take your questions. And of course, if you do wish to reach out to me, you can find my contact details below. But that just leaves me now to say thank you for your attention, and I'll now proceed to answer any questions you might have. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much, Edward James, Director of Content and Analysis at MEED Projects there. An excellent presentation and overview, and a very encouraging outlook, in fact, as well, which is brilliant news. We have had quite a few questions come in for you. Now, you mentioned some of the drivers of growth, of course, in your presentation: population growth, energy transitions, Chinese investment. So this first question for you is, what is the most exciting driver of projects for you in particular, and why?
Thank you, Laura. I think When we're looking at, in terms of expectations and the size of the future market going forward and where all the hype is and where one is looking and excited about, I really think it's Saudi Arabia and the framework for project investment created by the Saudi 2030 vision. If we look forward over the next 18 to 24 months, we can see a real acceleration and pickup in project activity there. And it's all being driven by the government and its Giga Projects program under the PIF, but also many other government entities. And I believe that that's really the one driver that everyone's getting really excited about and which everyone is dedicating a lot of their resources and time to. So we've already started to see the last few weeks a big pickup in activity. And as we go into 2022, I expect that to generate further momentum and really to see a real explosion in project activity in the kingdom.
We move on now to another question, actually, which has a KSA focus. What is the impact of the recent announcements from the UAE and KSA on infrastructure going to have on the growth of those markets in particular?
Yeah, so I think it's all tied up with what I've been presenting in the presentation in the last question. Everything is being driven by the need to diversify the economy, by the need to create new economic sectors, by the need to create jobs and to attract foreign investment. And this is particularly the case in Saudi Arabia under the framework of that Saudi 2030 vision. It's really pointing the way forward to divestment into tourism, into generating in non-oil-based industrial development, into attracting new segments into the economy, such as programming and coding, like we also see here in Dubai. It's about transitioning to a post-COVID world and to a world beyond oil. For example, a good example in case is the development of the hydrogen industry in the GCC and wider MENA region. It's also emblematic of a sort of a new economy and a new direction that that the region is taking.
And now you also mentioned, you know, the MENA market is very much open for business wherever you're based, basically. Mm. So this next question is very fitting. Which city in the MENA region in particular do you think is going to rapidly grow and change the most over the next couple of years? That's which city in particular in the MENA region?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. But I think this is an obvious answer. I think if we're looking at one city that's going to change more than any other, it has to be Riyadh. Obviously, Saudi Arabia has maybe lagged behind in certain areas of development over the last two or three decades, talking development of entertainment infrastructure, for example, and tourism infrastructure as a good case in point. Now, in the last couple of years, we've really seen a transformation in the ambition and dream for Riyadh. We've seen some really large giga project, mega project announcements, such as the Qiddiya Entertainment City in the outskirts of Riyadh, which is going to create a kind of like Saudi Disneyland for both Saudi citizens, expatriates, and international tourists. It's going to transform the entertainment scene in Riyadh and the kingdom as a whole. We're also seeing the development of the Diriyah Gate UNESCO World Heritage Site, with a large retail and residential district, golf courses and so on, that's going to be in keeping with the heritage site theme. That's also going to transform living and working in Riyadh. We've also got King Salman International Park, which is going to be the world's largest park filled with cultural activities, greenery, various sporting facilities as well, retail and residential developments. And of course, we've got other elements such as Green Riyadh, Riyadh Art, which are going to make Riyadh one of the hotspots for cultural, residential and sporting activities and developments in the region. I've also got the planting of millions of trees as part of Green Riyadh, which will visually transform the city. And as the largest city in the GCC, it's going to really come into its own and become the preeminent destination for investment in the region. It's going to take some time. It's going to take 5, maybe 10, maybe longer years. but it's being rapidly transformed as we speak. And this is really under the vision of the Saudi 2030 vision. Now, it's not the only city that's going to change. We've also got other cities in the kingdom, Jeddah, Mecca, Medina, and the new touristic developments along the Red Sea coast as well, which are going to be transforming the kingdom. But I think Riyadh is really where it is going to see the most transformation over the next decade.
Well, speaking of Saudi, very exciting place to be right now. Tell us a little bit more about some of the focus on green projects. So I do know that a lot of the projects that you've mentioned really do have sustainability and environmental wellness at their core, don't they? So this next question that's coming that comes through from our audience is, will there be more focus on green projects in the future in general?
Yes, it definitely seems that way. As I mentioned, we've got Green Riyadh, which is about beautifying and transforming Riyadh into a nicer place to live and work visually. Planting of millions of trees, installation of parks, more outdoor activity areas, sports, whether it's sporting districts or whether it's cultural areas such as Riyadh Art with sculptures and with outdoor cultural events and so on. There is a realization that in order to attract investment and to be successful, cities also need to look the part and to attract people to come and live within them. And they also need to be beautified as much as possible. It's not just in Riyadh, it's across the kingdom cities, but across the GCC as a whole, Qatar, Doha as well, Dubai and Abu Dhabi. All the major cities in the region are focusing on beautification. Now, it comes at some cost because clearly the beautification requires a lot of water. So there's a focus on water reuse and greater water production in order to irrigate the beautified trees and the shrubberies and the bushes and the flowers that beautification comes with. But it's all about just sprucing up cities to look the part as they seek to attract tens of billions of dollars of investment. So very much it's a growing area and it's something that's going to continue for the next decade.
We do actually have an expo question here, but I'm going to leave that to last. So just before we move on to the expo question, what challenges, this is another one that's come in, what challenges could delay its spending plans?
Yeah, well, there was always a lot of challenges around in the development of projects, and especially when you're looking at a significant increase in activity levels and investment levels that we are expecting from next year onwards. Clearly, financing is always a challenge. How to finance projects, where's the money going to come from to pay for them? Obviously, if you look at the case of Saudi Arabia, there has been some asset sales which have generated some cash. There's been some sales of foreign assets as well, which have helped the IPOing of Aramco, which has freed up some cash for investment. There's also the drive to get more PPP projects on board, get the private sector more involved in the financing and development and owning of projects. And we've got construction risk as well, of course, payment delays to contractors, which is always a potential problem. You've got potentially a good problem in the fact that with a facing significant increase and acceleration in projects, you've got an issue around engineering, supply capacity, contracting capacity as well, which could rear its head. And recently as well, you've got this logistics issue around the increase in transportation costs and delays in transportation due to the emergence from the lockdown and the very significant and very short-term increase in demand for certain products and materials, which could also hinder project development. So you've got all those long-term issues, which we always see, but also you've got some of those shorter-term ones as well, which could be problematic. But the region has got a long now experience of developing projects and attracting investment, and I'm sure it's more than well equipped and experienced enough to be able to overcome these challenges.
Moving on to our final audience question now. Do you think that Expo 2020 will lead to some major projects in the UAE next year?
Well, I don't think the Expo itself directly will create additional projects in and around the Expo site itself. We've already seen that. We've already experienced that, those $5 billion investments in Expo directly. But what Expo has clearly done is created a huge buzz in Dubai and the UAE as a whole. Anyone who lives in the country can see the increase in traffic levels, the increase in number of tourists, the pickup in economic activity. So on the back of the Expo, indirectly, has been this increase in consumer confidence and business confidence and all the economic metrics that make Dubai work. And so through this indirect way, we are seeing already greater investment in real estate, which in turn leads to more project launches, which of course leads to more project opportunities as well. And then, of course, that trickles down into other sectors, and whether it's oil-based or non-oil-based. So whether it's, we've seen some industrial investments recently, such as in hydrogen, for example. We're also seeing potential investments in transport, extension of the Etihad rails, a good case in point. And so the Expo has helped, along with the emergence of lockdown, along with this return to normality, it's helped generate this buzz, which in turn has led to, I believe, a very strong return to confidence and increase in investments and projects as a result.
Very good to know. A very healthy future ahead, it seems, and that's going to keep everyone very busy. So, Edward James, thank you so much for your time. A great session there, and thank you so much for your project outlook. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we will be back at 1:45 Gulf Standard Time with a session on engineering for the future. So we'll see you then at 1:45.